We are extremely delighted to have him here. We are really, really fortunate to have you in our midst today, and hope this day will be very, very fruitful to every one of us who are going to hear you. And this is going to be a very productive day, wherein we can benefit from your knowledge and thoughts on the areas of finance, wherein most of our students are trying to specialize in the years to come at our institute. And we also are very thankful to Dr. Geeta, who is an IPN earlier, but still she is trying to maintain and relate with us and maintain our network with us. And we are very thankful that she has helped us to facilitate this interface with Professor Robert. And we are extremely thankful to her for bringing him all the way from Australia to India and then to Hyderabad. And thanks, Geeta. I take this privilege to welcome everyone, and on behalf of the Institute of Public Enterprise, my director Dr. Mishra and our dean Dr. Murthy, and along with our students, we welcome you to this interactive session today. Before we start the program, I would like to read out Professor Robert's brief CV to all of you. It has been placed in the website, and some students have really gone through, and then they were really amazed to see the credentials that he has attained. But for those who have not known him, I'll just briefly introduce so that we can start our interface today. Professor Robert Faff is a professor of finance and director of research at the UQ Business School, University of Queensland, Brisbane, Australia. He has an international reputation in empirical finance research, securing 13 ARC grants, which have been funded around $4 million, and more than 290 referred journals publications have been carried out, and he has exceeded citations more than 8,200, and has an HI index of around 47 as a part of the Google Scholar network. And his particular passion in nurturing and developing the career trajectories of the earlier career researchers. And Robert has served more than 30 PhD students for the successful completion of the doctoral research. And he has examined more than 50 PhD dissertations. And his research interests include asset pricing, risk modeling, managed fund performance, behavioral finance, corporate governance, and market efficiency. And his signature work, which is titled as Pitching Research, has been very useful for all the budding researchers throughout the world. We are extremely happy that he is in our midst today, and I hope our students really will get benefit from his interactions, and you're free to talk to him regarding the areas of finance so that you all can benefit. Thank you so much for being with us. I request Professor Mishra to say a few words on welcoming Professor Robert Faff.
We have an internationally known eminent professor of finance in our midst, with the HI index, as Kiran told, 47. Harsh index is a very, very important index, and Harsh index shows the contribution of professor, how much, you know, one has contributed. And 47 is a score, I think, you know, unimaginable. It's a very, very high score, and I wish, I think, many of our colleagues, they do something, I think, and they also come up on the HI index. Weather is not good, but not bad too. It has become better with Professor Faff here. But more than that, I think the weather in Brisbane in India or Hyderabad, the weather are same, I think. Because when you talk Australia, Australia has different zones. And Brisbane weather is very close to the weather in India and Bangladesh. So I'm glad that Professor Faff is with us. And I think he will find the same weather that you know you have in Brisbane. All the areas in which he has worked are very, very important areas, and they are being applied, I think, throughout the world at the micro level, also at the macro level. Today, very informally, I had requested Professor to give us an insight into the area of finance. I am very glad that you have published in the behavioral finance area also, and last 3-4 years the Nobel Prizes which have gone in the area of finance, they have gone to the behavioral finance specialist, especially the Nobel that went last year and the year before last. behavioral finance is an emerging area. And that's where I think finance becomes very important, because finance as a part of classroom teaching is one. Finance as a part of molding, you know, is another kind of finance. Finance on the periphery is the third kind of finance. And finance that you and I do every day, finance that you and I, you know, use every day, that you and I apply every day, that you and I practice every day, that I think is a very, very important branch of finance, that is behavioral finance. And today, most of the policies in the area of finance, they are being formulated keeping, you know, that element into consideration. On that note, I extend a very, very hearty welcome on behalf of the Dean and all my colleagues, Professor Pawan Kumar has also come. Pawan has done wonderful work in the area of valuation. He is in touch with Pablo Fernandez. Pablo Fernandez regularly corresponds with Professor Pawan Kumar. We also have Vivek here. And behavioral finance is nothing but it comes from, you know, your behavioral area. Finance is all inclusive. Today we talk of inclusive finance also, or we talk of financial inclusion. I'm glad what Kiran spoke about Dr. Geeta, I think is very, very true. Dr. Geeta is an ambassador of India to Australia, to New Zealand. She has brought a great name to IPE. She has brought a great name to the people who are working in the area of finance. And she has two PhDs, one PhD in India, the other PhD from New Zealand, has published prolifically. Again, I think is on Social Science Research Index, and also Google Scholar, and I think many other indexes. She's very, very high, and she's working in the areas which are, you know, the emerging areas in the in the field of finance. She has been our visiting professor, and I hope next time she goes beyond visiting India, but spending some time, I think, at the institute teaching, I think, all of you. On that note, let me extend a very, very hearty welcome. I was also telling that finance has gone beyond the classroom teaching. Only yesterday I was in the BRICS conference for the last 3 days, where we had deputy prime ministers, ambassadors of different countries in Goa. And that was all devoted to the area of finance. There we discussed multilateral finance. Multilateral finance is very, very interesting. Now, BRICS Bank is coming now. BRICS Bank, $100 billion. BRICS Emergency BRICS Infrastructure Fund is under $100 billion. BRICS Cash Contingency Fund is under $50 billion. This all put together is $300 billion, which is 50% of the IMF. IMF is $650 billion. And now, we are creating a new architecture of finance. And this world architecture of finance is something which will dominate, I think, many countries in the times to come. Regional finance, multilateral finance. These are, I think, which are developing on the periphery. And I hope, I think, we learn more and more. And today, we are fortunate, rather, to have Professor Faff with us. And we are grateful to him that he's giving the day to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I now request Dr. Geeta to say a few words before we request Professor to say more about finance. She can talk about our networking with New Zealand University so that students also can benefit hearing what kind of collaborative research that IPE is trying to extend working with Geeta. So I request Geeta to say a few words.
A bit shocking. Good morning to you all. All of a sudden, I'm invited to share my experiences and views. And well, to start, coming to IPE, visiting to IPE is like coming home to me. And the credit goes to Professor Mishra. And he makes me feel I'm back home. So that's my link and relation to the IPE. Although I had been away from India since on and off since 2000. I still maintain the links, and the relationship is the same as when I left. Professor Mishra was my PhD supervisor. This is how, actually, let me share my experiences or the journey I started my association with IPE. I belong to Kakatiya University. I've done my postgraduate, MCOM, MPhil, M.Ed from Kakatiya University, but I was very keen to do PhD. And one day I'd been to administrative staff college because I had the thirst to read books, look into the books. I thought Kakatiya University Library wasn't really having the kind of books that I was looking for. So I finally landed up in ASCII Library and I came to see Professor Mishra, books written by Mishraji. Then I thought, wow. Then looked at the address and the details. Then I thought it is in Hyderabad, IP is in Hyderabad, and this author is in Hyderabad. I should meet him. This is what I shared back to my professors in Kakatiya University, and they have given me directions, and that was the, these were the things, experiences that prompted me towards coming to IP. And my one single interaction with Professor Mishraji, it was really wonderful, it was really great, and he agreed to be my research supervisor, and you can imagine the experience I might have undergone between these two moments. I just wanted to see the author of the book, and finally I ended up he had become my chief supervisor of my PhD. So that was the journey. Anyway, I've done my PhD while I was in Africa for 6-7 years, and balancing between international, two countries doing my PhD, it was all worthwhile. And I had the thirst. I'm paid well, I'm settled well. It's in Addis Ababa University, good university known in the continent, but I thought I should improve in my research and have better experience. And in all these aspects, the final motivation, the final energy I've drawn from Professor Mishra. We know God is great, we have faith, and that is very important. Above all, Professor Mishra was very inspirational, very supportive, and his energy levels are so high. The positive vibe was too much that I could go to New Zealand, do. Yeah, there were challenges. Finally, I've done my thirst for international experience and for research collaborations made me pursue another degree, and luckily I got the supervisors the same as Professor Mishra in New Zealand, Professor Stewart Lawrence and Professor Stuart Locke. So the journey of my career was in a safe hands, and the sail was a bit was smooth, I could say. And I'm now able to know what I'm doing and what I want to do. So the journey becomes very tough after we finish our PhD, and where we have to talk in front of people like Professor Faff and Professor Mishra. It's not very simple. I have to hesitate twice if I have to touch upon the subject. And meeting Professor Faff is another very wonderful and amazing experience. And I had to be in wait for 1 year or 1.5 year and about to get a communication link and connection to him. So every minute I spend with him is very important, and it has great significance, value in my career. And today I'm more eager, as anxious as you all to make a presentation before him. I'm feeling like a debut, a starting or emerging or budding scholar, as Kiran said. I'm trying to find space in the international, to publish in the international scholarly journal, and being with him, listening to his lectures or presentations at Delhi University, FMS, and Central University, Hyderabad, was a continuous professional development workshops. To me, it was very useful, and probably I'll do my little presentation and try to get a good or a harsh or good or whatever comments I want to just break the ice and get something out of it from him. So having Professor Faff with us is really a big opportunity, and he is quite well known. You might have seen, those who have browsed, you might have seen, take the opportunity. You might have not understood what the pitching research template is, but with Professor Mishra, I'm sure Professor Faff will be inclined to visit IP again and again. So in this visit, you frame an idea what to do, how to do, what good inspiration you can take from him, insights you can take from him, try to talk to him or try to listen what he says and absorb it in your whatever you're doing, and try to connect yourself when he comes back, or he's very active on social media. So try to take advantage of that visibility also. So this is all I say. Research journey is very tough. It's not very easy. It's not, there's no shortcut to this. It's a complete, a commitment, a dedication, a hard work. And finally, that's how you end up with a contentment and contribution to the society. And having Professor Mishra here, Professor Faff, is a great day to me, and also hope Kiran. Yeah, I'm very happy to come back, be at IP. Thank you.
Thank you for those wonderful words, Geeta. Always we at IPE, all faculty colleagues, whenever we meet, we talk about you, your journey to from Ethiopia to India to New Zealand. We always take that as a great inspiration for us, because sometimes we are not able to do what we wanted, but you could make it and you made us proud. So thanks so much. Now, before I request Professor Faff to say a few words on finance, I request two of our budding students who are going to specialize to hand over a bouquet to you, Pratyusha and Ritu. Please hand over a bouquet to Professor and Dr. Geeta. Thank you. Now the floor is all yours, Professor. So you can talk about finance. Either you can use the on research. Yes, research. Thank you.
Sorry, can you hear me? Ah, I can. Very good. Thank you very much for those kind words. It's a great pleasure to come along and talk to you about, well, research generally. I'll say a few words on finance, but I think it's far more important that I try and give you some words of wisdom about how to attack the journey of research. It's incredibly challenging. It's challenging for anyone in research, senior people in research, those like myself that have been dealing with research matters for many decades, we still struggle. So I struggle. And I shouldn't emphasize that too much, because that might make you a little concerned that someone that has built a career around research still struggles. But I think that's important. We had a deep conversation earlier with Professor Mishra, and he imparted a lot of his philosophies on me, and those of you that have heard him before will know the types of things that he told me. And while I didn't have a chance much to squeeze a word in, I found myself agreeing very much with what he was saying, and I think one of the messages I got from his wisdom was that every day is a struggle. Every day we need to take on challenges. And my spin on this is that if we remain in a comfort zone in whatever we do, and we're thinking about research right now, if we remain in a comfort zone, then we won't do as well as we could if we challenge ourselves, and if we recognize the challenges that face us and do our very best to produce something that we are proud of, that meets those challenges. And I think more and more these days, to address or achieve two very important objectives. So the traditional one is the scholarly objective. So where we're studying at an institution of higher learning, the scholarly objective is very important. So we need to ensure that we belong to the community of scholars. And this community of scholars have a very traditional and established way of telling us how we should do that. And a lot of that is around the scholarly journals. Now that's very important, and that's the underlying sort of fabric of tertiary education, of universities and education institutions like that. But following my theme just before of challenges, the 21st century is now more and more telling us that we can't just rely on that tradition, that the scholarly work is important, but the second goal that we should have is also very, very important, and that is really demonstrating where we can that we are engaged with stakeholders beyond academia, that we're engaged with stakeholders beyond the scholarly tradition, and that we try and position our research as much as possible so that it has an impact beyond academia. Okay, so two important twin goals in this brave new world that we face for academics and for academic research. The scholarly goal, and then the goal that, I guess another way of putting it is that wherever possible, we choose research that has a scholarly focus but tries to solve real world problems. It won't always happen, and it's possibly not the safest place to start as a young scholar, as a PhD student. The safest place to start is one where the scholarly tradition is the predominant. But what I would try and impart on you and suggest to you that if you choose a topic that immediately doesn't have that second goal of engagement and impact beyond academia, that as you develop your career, you try and think through a strategy how that particular path that you take will allow you, when you develop your career, to have that broader goal and that wider impact, so that you can demonstrate to external stakeholders, important stakeholders like governments, policymakers, regulators, industry bodies, corporations, companies, small, medium enterprises, managers, shareholders, customers, whoever they are, whoever those stakeholders are, that you're able to convert a scholarly output into an output that also means something to them, to those stakeholders. And if you can do that longer term, then I think you're going to enjoy your work much more, you're going to enjoy your research, you're going to be able to demonstrate that you have created a line of research that meets two masters. And that's the brave new world of research that when I started, it was never mentioned, it was never talked about, and at least in the area of finance, economics, accounting, no one really cared about it, there was very little concern about that. Now, in a context like you have here, the types of research questions that scream out for you to work on in finance, I think are fairly obvious and self-evident. Things like microfinance. So trying to embrace the challenge of situations where there are huge populations of people that are struggling economically and financially, but they need the resources to be able to meet the objectives that they have in their lives. And they can't go to the normal finance sources that we read about in textbooks. Of course, this is self-evident. There's much work that's being done in this area, and I've got this sneaking suspicion that there's quite a deal of activity in this space that occurs right in this institution. So I feel a little uneasy to, in a sense, be preaching to the converted. But clearly something of particular relevance to your setting is something like microfinance. And if I can broaden that theme a little further, in choosing your research, it is only natural that you would choose your setting to be one of India or a sub-region of India. Now, I've been working really hard this week with Geeta, and we've been at Delhi University, and we had a great session there. We had a great session at Hyderabad Central University yesterday. So over the course of those 2 days, we listened to 24 young scholars pitch their research. And almost in every case, the research that was being pitched had an Indian setting. There are no surprises there. There are no surprises, and I'm not here to tell you that that's wrong. What I would like to try and convince you is that for some of those topics that we listen to, that you haven't heard obviously, but for some of those topics they had, and for topics that you might have, these will be very meaningful to a domestic and regional audience, no question. And for many of you, that goal will be a great goal, and that's the primary goal that you should take on. But for some, you can aspire, you can challenge yourself so much more, because the setting that is natural to you will turn out to be a setting that provides you with an ideal environment to engage outside to the broader world, to the global community of scholars that are interested in the question that you're addressing. Now, the microfinance one, I think, is a very good one, because a natural setting for that, and I must preface what I'm about to say, I'm not an expert in microfinance at all, so I'm trying to use some logic as I speak to you now in terms of what makes sense to me, that in places like India, this will be the ideal setting, and for those global scholars that are interested in the challenges of financing at this micro scale, it won't be too difficult to sell your work into the global community. And that will be really important, because that will not only signal to you that your work is being valued at such on a big scale, but also that you are engaging and that you have impact on that big scale. But microfinance is clearly not the only area. Some of the work that I have been involved in very recent times would also be quite relevant, and I might mention briefly. One of these is an area of social impact bonds, where basically it's a way in which governments can finance particular social programs in a way that takes the pressure off their budgets. And it's particularly in the early phases of some of these programs, these social programs. For example, programs where we're looking at those in our society that, for whatever reason, have, let's say, gotten on the wrong side of the law. So they've done some things they shouldn't have. They've ended up being punished for that, so they've gone to jail. And then the government's concerned about, well, is this a path way to, a spiralling pathway in a direction that's not good for society and not good for those individuals. And so there are programs that are trying to address the concern, particularly of youth, where they make some mistakes early on, and this is costly. These programs are costly and they're risky. Well, they're high risk in the sense that the government could put up a significant amount of funding for these programs and they may not work. They may not be successful. So these social impact bonds are a way in which they engage other partners into the process that essentially get a source of financing outside of the government, and the providers of these finance are likely to be driven by a social goal. All right, and this is the brave new world of finance as well, because if you go down the standard neoclassical rational path of what drives the engine room of finance, it's all around maximising profits, maximising wealth of shareholders, and it's a very it's a very individual utility maximising, but utility very narrowly defined around dollars and wealth. And I think as the decades have gone on and there's been a broader appreciation of the idea that utility, the degree of satisfaction that we have from the things that we do can derive from things that are non-financial and that are in the realms of doing social good, then this is opening the door for a new perspective on finance, and I guess a trend where for those that have that particular passion and bent, they can derive great satisfaction and benefit, as well as seeing benefit occur in a broader sense. Anyway, going back to social impact bonds, essentially the reward to the provider of finance would be conditional on such programs being successful. So clearly you need a definition of what success is. So if we take this case where we're trying to create a program of making it less likely that someone will break the law again, do a criminal act again, so a youth, some measure of success there. If there is success, then the providers of the finance for these bonds will receive a return. But if that success is not achieved, then they get no return. All right, so there's a degree of risk there, and it's something that's attractive to governments around the world, but in a very small scale right now, but attractive to governments around the world for the reasons that should be self-evident. It's taking pressure off budgets in times when pressure on budgets are severe. It's taking pressure off that risk, that initial risk. So you can imagine that some of these programs right now are like pilot programs. And where they show success, that would be then a green light for governments to say, okay, this works, now we can find, and maybe it's a combination of finding the funding from within the government budget, as well as seeing whether there are follow-up funders for these social impact bonds. So these are very small propositions right now. There are some key examples worldwide, including in Australia and in the US as well. I'm not sure whether there are any in India. But I guess broadening the theme a little there is, in terms of choosing your research, it may not be around something like social impact bonds, or it may not be exactly on microfinance. But what it could well be is a reflection of your investigation of trends that are, you know, new trends that are happening in the realms of finance in the real world. So something that's new that looks like it's going to take hold, and wherever there's something that's new that looks like it's going to take hold, there will be questions. There will be questions that attract academic attention, and if these occur to you as something that's appealing, for which you can get a passion, then that would be potentially a good choice for you to choose as your topic. Research or passion is important. Passion in research is important. In fact, in different ways, passion in many aspects of our lives are important. So I can't lecture about your broader lives, but let me focus or narrow it down to research. I see a lot of passionate students, and I encourage that in you. I do have a warning, however. Passion does have a bad side. And I can imagine right now, many of you in the room are thinking, oh, goodness, how could this be? If I'm passionate, that must be good. So let me try to explain to you where I see a potential problem with passion. Passion can become so strong that it suddenly converts us from being a scientist to someone that has a faith. Faith is important, and I don't want to get into that controversial area, so please don't misinterpret what I'm about to say. But when we are talking about research, we're not talking about faith. As soon as we talk about faith, we should be doing something else where that's important. As scientists, our passion should be about the question. Our passion should allow us to have an open mind. Our passion should allow us to be as objective as we possibly can be. And in some students that I see early on, I can see the passion has gone over the line, that the passion turns into a faith, the passion turns into a drive where that researcher has a goal of proving something that they already know. Now, if you want to be a researcher, you don't know the answer. And in fact, you'll never know the answer. Your goal is to try and systematically, following the scientific approach that has been established in your field, allows you to, as objectively as possible, gather evidence that will give support to whatever the unknown truth in quotes, because we'll never know the truth, the evidence in support of or against whatever hypotheses that we set up or predictions that we can make that are informed by the appropriate theory and the models in our field. So we have to have an open mind when we choose a research topic. We have to accept that there are a number of possible outcomes to our research, and that we have to accept, once we follow all of the appropriate protocols and methodological designs that are best practice in our field, whatever that analysis delivers, we should stand by it. Now, what one can be suspect is happening, particularly for those that are very passionate and they have a faith, that they will do analysis, they will get results, and if the results don't line up with their faith, even though they followed all of the protocols, all of the method, the best practice in their field, they won't stop. And I guess the problem is that the menu of possibilities that we have around research design is enormous. absolutely enormous. The combinations, the permutations of things that you can do that you can, after the fact, justify in quotes, and say, you know, I followed everything that I should and here are the results. The problem is there are too many possibilities, too many ways of designing our research. And so what I would really urge you to do, whether you go down the path of microfinance, whether you go down the path of something like these social impact bonds, whether you go down the path of, say, behavioural finance, which was mentioned by Professor Mishra as well. And that's an emerging area as well that you could well consider a pathway. That whichever the path you choose, you be true to yourself. That you don't fall for the trap, let me put it under the label of research integrity, that the research that you do does have integrity, that you believe in that research for the reasons that a scientist would believe in it and not for the reasons that someone who has faith believes in it. And I think that's really important. I think governance is also another area that has been with us for a while and I think will continue to endure. Corporate governance and governance at a more general level, so ethical, social and sort of governance around corporate social responsibility generally, sustainability, all of those areas are very competitive, and that's something you need to bear in mind as well. When you make a choice of a topic and an area and a direction and a path and a pathway, you won't be alone. Now the good news is that some of those that you encounter as you go along that path, you will be able to develop a network and create strong links where you will be on a team. And pretty much all of, from my own personal experience, all of my most exciting, my most rewarding, my greatest memories are those in teams. So I'd encourage you to do that. But as you go down a path, particularly one where there are a number of people, many, many people worldwide that are interested in that area, everyone can't be on your team. It goes without saying. So you naturally have competitors, and with competition, as it is in all walks of life, sport, for example, we know that the Australian cricket team is a very strong cricket team, and okay, I can tell that people are listening. So there's lots of competition in the sporting field, and sadly Australia isn't the strength that it used to be, so I'm very sad about that. But I'm willing to admit that India has become very strong. So competition is important, and that represents a challenge for us, as we mentioned earlier. So going back to research, we have to be aware of what our competition are doing, and we need to condition the way we deal with our research goals that takes into account our perception of and our knowledge of what our competitors are doing. And this could have a variety of outcomes for us. It might mean that we decide we have to give an extreme priority to our research, to the extent that, well, it's already important to us, but our competitors are so strong and we feel we are competitive that we need to try and, for at least a short intensive period, cut out as much as we can of in our lives so that we focus, not literally, but 24/7 on our research. Now, this is largely going to impact our personal lives, because this is where we definitely will need support from our family and the ones closest to us. And so if in those situations where we can get that support, it's going to be incredibly important. But we should not aim to do that long term. So it's sort of like going home and saying to the family, something has come up with my research, and for the next 2 weeks, 4 weeks, I really, really have to make my life simple. I apologise now, I'll make it up to you at the end, we'll go on a holiday, we'll do something, but right now I have to work on this paper and deliver it so that, or get it in a shape, so that, or you wouldn't say this to your family, but what you're thinking in your mind is that you're, in a sense, staking a claim in an area that you're very passionate about and you want to be a part of. There will be other instances where you look at the competition and you have an assessment of your own setting, your own skills, and you decide it's an okay idea, but it's not a good one for you to compete in. All right? So you're a really good cricketer. There's no point you trying to compete in soccer, or no point you trying to compete in ping pong. You have to recognise where your strengths are, and make the appropriate call. Now, some of us are all rounders. All right, we're very, you know, we just seem to be natural, because we're very modest. We would never say that to anyone, but we sort of figure, I'm pretty, you know, I think I can be skillful in a lot of areas. Well, you still have to make some decisions. It's good to keep the flexibility as long as you can. Being good students of finance, you understand options and the value of options and the value of flexibility, the strategic value that it has. There will come points, however, points in our sort of careers and our research journey where we have to let some options slide. It's almost like the expiry date comes and we exercise or we don't. But flexibility is important, and being strategic in a good way, I think, is important. Strategic in a way that it works, but it's not obvious to anyone but yourself, and it's not like you would think about it on a daily basis. You have long-term goals, medium-term goals, very short-term goals. You need to ensure that they are all compatible, and you really then, as long as you know that the short-term are leading somewhere, you don't think every day about what the longer-term goals are. Now, with the short-term goals, you behave in a very courteous way, you behave in a way that's true to yourself and your personality, but you are very focused and passionate and in a good way strategic. I see and have seen over the years colleagues and junior researchers and academics that are clearly very strategic and very very dedicated and very ambitious, and there's nothing wrong with any of those. The problem with some of these people, however, is it's too obvious. In fact, it's so obvious that it's counterproductive. So the real challenge for you then will be to have all of those characteristics, to package them in a way that they work for you, they don't work against you. What I'd like to do, I think I've hopefully covered now, you know, there's a lot of pressure on me to talk about finance, and I've touched on a few areas, and I wasn't really, you know, I hadn't prepared to do this at all. This has just been totally off the top of my head. Really what my passion is something that hopefully you're all eager to learn about as well, and it's just the general challenge of starting research. I'm assuming pretty much everyone in the room, we all have the common interest in wanting to do research, that we committed ourselves to that, but we're all very, very new to this journey. And it's only natural, and my experience is you have feelings of despair. You are lost, you feel like you're swimming in a big ocean. Well, how do I start? what are the things that I can do that will get me heading in the right direction? And so what I've done in the last few years is really synthesize and crystallize in my mind a very succinct set of guidelines and advice. And a lot of this has just been based on my own experience, and you know, there are many around that have had as much experience as me or as more, and they would know more than me. And I think the only thing that distinguishes me from them is that I've gone crazy and they have remained sane. All right, why have I gone crazy? I've decided to devote pretty much the rest of my academic life to this general topic of helping people like you. So I'm less interested about talking about specific areas of research in finance, to be quite honest. I think I can do that okay. I'm much more interested in trying to impart on you a strategy of how you can start research. And I've seen a lot of bad strategies. And let me tell you one, because it's relevant to the theme of this pitching research. It's a bad strategy, but on the face of it, it looks quite a good strategy. Now, the bad strategy is having done a whole lot of really hard work. So that's a good thing. So reading a lot of papers, spending weeks, months, immersing yourself in literature, feeling quite lost, and writing up a document. At the moment, it's not bad. Where does it turn bad? It turns bad because pretty much as a result of the fact that you're lost, we tend to be too verbose. We tend to just put every thought that we've ever had, and ever, you know, in terms of reading the literature on paper. Well, at least typing it in, and then if it gets printed or not, who knows? I mean, these days maybe things don't get printed so much. And we have this big long document, and that's the bad thing. It shows a lot of effort. It shows a lot of dedication. It shows a lot of hard work. What's the problem with it? It's 60 pages long, 50 pages long, 45 pages long. I can go even 20 pages long. Too long. Why is it too lengthy? It's too lengthy because you're trying to convince someone. Most, you know, so the situation I'm thinking of is you're trying to convince someone that's very experienced in research to give you advice. To give them a big long document, I can almost guarantee you will walk away disappointed. You'll walk away disappointed because someone like myself is overcommitted, hugely overcommitted. Just, we agree to do far too many things. We travel too much. So right now, back in Brisbane, where I live, the University of Queensland, that's where I work. I can just in my mind now visualize outside my office. The door's shut because I'm not there. If I'm there, the door's open. And right now, one of my students has just walked past my door. They see you, the door's shut. They're shaking their heads. The shoulders are slumped. Where is he? And then they think, aha, he's having fun somewhere. He's not in Australia. He's some in exotic location, just, you know, lapping up luxury, not working at all, avoiding me, so avoiding the student, and this is terrible. And this is the life of a dedicated academic. I guess I am a little bit extreme. I travel too much. I agree to do too many things, and sometimes we end up having to do things that we don't really agree to. And I know, you know, deans sort of impose upon us sometimes, and so we're just too busy. We can't look at 45 pages. It's a bad strategy. The other characteristic I have in this context, it's quite relevant. I'm the worst example of this, and I'm sure you don't see anyone as bad as me, but I'm grumpy. Right, I know you can't, you couldn't possibly tell that I'm grumpy right now because I've kept a smile on my face and I'm trying to engage you. But I'm super grumpy sometimes and I don't like it. It's a flaw in my personality, but it's brought on by probably not sleeping enough because I'm doing too many things, traveling too much, putting too much pressure on myself. So what's the solution? The solution is for you to, at least at the beginning of this journey, you're going to be lost, but force you to convert all of these words into a much shorter document. And the way I define it, or think of it, is 2 pages, but I know a lot of you have worked out in Word how to use the font variation, so you can get it down to 6-point font. I know a lot of you know how to make the margins really narrow, sort of 5-millimeter margins. I know that a lot of you have figured out the font style that allows you to get more words on the page. Bad strategy. So if I told you two pages, that would make me grumpy again because I wouldn't be able to read it properly. So another way of thinking of it is I'm going to give you a contract, 1,000 words. You've got 1,000 words. You've got to convert your ideas and thoughts into 1,000 words. Now that's really challenging, but I'm going to help you out. The 1,000 words, I'm going to give you a structure. I'm going to give you a structure, a tool that defines a structure that, in my experience, if you can make a really serious attempt at answering this structure, giving responses in this structure, then, well, you've at least you'll at least achieve one thing. You'll go over a very important psychological barrier, because psychologically, I can cope with 2 pages. Think of it this way, that if I were to print that, and I mean with 2 pages, I probably don't need to print it, but I don't need to staple it. All right? There's no staples required. It will print back to back. And the psychology is important, because if another way of thinking about it is if we are about to have a meeting, all right, so I like to have 30-minute meetings with my students. I can't let them have any longer because they'll just keep talking for, you know, forever. And I told you, I'm grumpy. So in 30 minutes, even if I've never seen this document before, and you walk through the door and you say, "Hi, Professor, how are you?" And I say, "Hi, and I've forgotten your name." Because I do that, so I'm very forgetful. And you say, "Sir, I'm sorry, I didn't email you this before the meeting, but this is what I've been working on." That's going to work. If you did the same thing with 45 pages, I would do my best in that 30 minutes, but I'm almost positive you would walk out of the room feeling sad because I'm just not able to consume that information and give you feedback. And even if you sent it to me a day before, 2 days before, because I'm so busy, I wouldn't look at it. Not because I don't like you and I'm not here for you, but particularly early on, I just don't have that time. So that's the philosophy of this pitching research approach. And so it basically, and I do have some slides, but maybe we're running out of time, but can I load up some slides?